share. Get your phones out. Link and share.
Oh,
link and share.
I have my phone.
Ah, link and share. I gave my phone to my wife. So Sammy, as people are watching, just call out their name. Anybody watching?
They don't want to do that.
Yeah. They do. Somebody call, I just want to know.
Hope Chapel.
Hey, we're getting ready. This is gonna be awesome. We're trying something different today, and it's gonna be a great time. Are we actually online?
Yeah.
Oh!
Cody's here.
Cody?
Cody.
Cody May. God bless you. My favorite nephew named Cody.
Patrick's watching. Patrick?
Patrick? I'm watching. Famous. Make it famous.
Wow.
I don't know where I'm going for this.
Joe's page.
Joe's page.
Good morning, Mrs. Ward.
Oh, hey, Kim.
Mrs. Ward says, hey guys.
Hey.
Hi.
Hey.
Hi, Mrs. Ward.
She says good.
Good.
Terry May's watching.
Hey, Terry.
You're ready to cross the road or the parking lot.
Good to see you, sis and moi. Although I don't see you, but yeah.
Good to be seen, though.
Yes, good to be seen.
Deborah Rochette says good morning.
Good morning.
Hey, Deborah. God bless you and Jane.
My household is watching.
Debbie, is Gina?
Behave.
Jane, is Gina in bed yet?
I go over to bed like.
God bless the Corbin family, most spiritual family on Spring Street.
Mrs. Ward says, I feel the love.
Oh, my aunt's watching. Hi, Auntie.
Nathaniel's watching. Oh my gosh, we're famous, guys.
Great.
Nate's watching.
My favorite drummer. Mercy's watching. Good morning, Mercy.
Hey, Mercy and Dylan.
Oh, Jane is in bed.
All right, no coffee for Jane this morning.
Ruth said hi.
Hey, Ruth. Hey, Ruth.
Guys, Tim's watching. Breaking news.
No way.
First name. I don't know who this is.
Who would have thunk it? All right. This is going good. Let's see what time we got. We got 9:56. Four more minutes. We're using government accounting.
Yes.
Guys, can we all confirm that you are at least 6 inches apart from each other? Please confirm that you are all at least 6 inches apart from each other.
We are. At least six.
No.
No, I don't think I am. We're going to be in we're doing a road trip later. So it's okay if we have six people or less in this proximity. We are six people. Therefore, we are obeying our government.
Kind of.
Kim says you're funny.
Really?
Yep.
The National Guard is here. We should show up with like brownies. Be like, hey guys.
Brownies.
Yeah, show to the National Guard and be like, hey guys.
Brownies. I think you like brownies.
That'd be a great excuse. I like brownies. But it's also a great excuse to like, you know, say hi to the people.
We have 2 minutes till we are 100% live, guys.
Okay. Cool. That is really great. Well, I can't wait to hear a testimony this morning.
lady who married a guy that was just not up to snuff. But we're making up to snuff. So, it's a work in progress.
How do you feel about that, Jacob?
And he's not talking about me, so.
No. Well, that's not. See, every smart man always marries a woman that is too good for him.
That's very true.
That's just what we do. We pick women who are out of our league and somehow scratch to the surface. Hey, Jen.
Hey.
And Jen's here, everybody.
Everybody's
on
Jen.
Hey, Jen.
Hello. If that can go closer to you somehow, the sound isn't good.
Oh, it is sound.
Okay, and you guys aren't using the mic for the swivel, so that doesn't work either.
Okay. Okay. Turn on your thing. Put the volume up. This guy sounds.
I got you.
That's the whole chat.
It's just a bit echoey. If one person's talking at a time, I think it's fine.
Is that full? Is that full?
That's
hey,
full
dude, awesome. Guys, we should get cameras for this. I mean, mics.
What?
We should get mics for this.
Why?
We don't have mics for this.
No, but we should get some
right here.
Yeah, we just gotta make sure we're not
Okay, so as we're speaking, it's a little late to change everything.
I mean, like,
just project.
Yep, we're just going to project.
Yeah.
All right, shout out to the audience, people. We're going to talk loud, and we're going to have this set up.
Carol Foley says, God bless you all.
Hey, Grandma Foley, good to see you.
Crystal head on.
Okay.
Hi, Grandma.
Patrick's a blessing.
Crystal, Oklahoma is watching.
Crystal and William, God bless you. You're my favorite cowgirl down south. She's awesome. She's a cowgirl. She rides horses and she does amazing things. Crystal. I am really sorry I missed your wedding, Crystal. I really wish I was there. But God bless you and all your happiness.
Good morning, Robinson family.
Hey. So, I'll tell you what. Let's start this morning with a word of prayer, and what we're going to do is we're just going to take turns. The people on the panel, the young men on the panel, are going to take turns just praying and blessing you, and I hope that as you're watching live stream that you will actually pray for the guys up here. So we're praying for you, and we want to interact. We want you to pray for us because we need your prayers. And so this morning we're going to start off by praying and interceding to God for each other. And don't pray for yourself. Pray for us. We're going to pray for you. And together we're going to just call upon God to do amazing things. We're going to start with Tim, and we're going to work our way this way. Okay.
Lord Jesus, thank you for today. Thank you for everybody watching. Lord, I thank you for all of the things you've done this week. Lord Jesus, thank you for today. Thank you for everything you have done for us this week. Thank you for everything you are going to continue to do this week, or this upcoming week. Lord, please bless everybody listening to this, and that they would hear something here that would speak to them, and that, Lord, you would touch every single person.
And Lord, I just pray for the families that are watching and the families that can't get together right now. I just pray that you would just bless all of them. Bless their time together. Bless their time just to regroup whatever is going on in their families, that they would just get all on the same page, and that through this quarantine that families would come out on the other side more together, more unified than ever before, that they would enjoy spending time with each other, and that they would enjoy each and every one of their family members. And so if they're missing one of the family members right now, give them a call, give them a text after this, and just tell people how much you love them. I pray for kids right now, that if they, for some who just graduated, I just pray that, I just want to let you guys know that we love you, the ones who graduate from high school or college, that we love you, and we're so glad that you guys graduate. I can't wait to see what you guys are doing in your lives to come up, and I know it's a little different not being able to walk, but we are walking with you, and we bless you as you move forward into your life.
Amen. Right now, I just pray for and bless all the small business owners. I received notification this week that several places that I go to, some mom-and-pop operations and family-owned businesses, will not be reopening their doors. And I just want to pray specifically for Kelly Cook. God bless you, Kelly. Arteries is not reopening where you work, where you manage. And Kelly, I just bless you and Zach in the name of Jesus Christ. May God fulfill you. May He pour out His blessings. May you find finances and jobs. I pray for all the small business leaders and business owners in the area that you would find financial success after this is over, which we wish it was over right now, but that's not the way it's happening. And Lord, I bless the people who are the company owners and the business leaders, and Lord, let them recoup. I pray for the employees that they would find and have better jobs. Amen.
Father, today we reach out and we just ask that you touch the people that are struggling emotionally during this time. God, we know that this is a hard time to be quarantined. A lot of people can't reach out to their network of support and be there physically and learn. We just ask that you help those with depression and anxiety and various mental disorders, that you just touch them and show your love to them and give them peace through this time, God. We ask that you heal them of their issues, but we really just ask for your power in your life. In your name, we pray.
Lord Jesus, I just pray for anyone right now who may be overlooked, for anyone who doesn't have anyone in their life, for people who are all by themselves, who are alone, who just don't have any family or friends nearby, for people who are homeless right now, who are out on the streets, for anyone who is battling any type of substance abuse or addiction. During this time, if you're going to pull them from that and save them from that and bring healing into their lives. Lord, you are a God who is mighty to save. And I just pray right now that you begin to save families, that you are healing and restoring families that are broken, families that are feeling like they're being torn apart, that you're going to mend it and you're going to heal those families. Bring them back stronger and closer together. Relationships between parents and children, between husband and wife, just restore marriages that are broken, Lord Jesus, and save them all and protect them all.
Lord, I ask you prayers for Jack, because he's so weak and tired right now. I ask that you give him strength that he will not grow weary, and that he will rise above the storm of life. I pray for the family of Mrs. Buckley, specifically for her ex-husband and her son, and you will get them through this time of grief, Lord. Lord, I pray for all those people who had to isolate themselves from both friends and family, who are alone in this time, that the end is near, it is coming, and we should all be able to greet each other again, see each other, and get back to the way things were before with a few extra precautions. Lord, I ask that for those who don't have a home during this time, that you try and keep them comfortable as the best they can be. Lord, we ask that you give health and hope and peace to everyone in this time. Amen, Lord.
Amen. So, right now, we're just kind of interacting with people on our live stream. What I'd like you to do is just take 1 minute right now and text, without any detail, the first name of someone you want us and you together, all of us, to pray for. And so what will happen is probably over the course of this week, there's going to be 1,000 people praying for that person. So just text one name of one person right now, and we're just going to all lift them up in prayer together. We're the body of Christ. We have power. We have thunder in our footsteps, lightning on our fists. We have the Holy Spirit. When we pray and we ask God to bless someone you care about, He blesses that person. Just because we ask and we have a good Father. So right now, just text the first name. If you're there, text the first name. If you're watching this recorded, hey, God bless you. Just scroll down and pray for those people. So right now, you're online, just text the first name. And just, guys, everybody.
We have three names here.
First one, just pray for those.
Lord, we pray for PJ, that you give him help in whatever he needs, and comfort and security and peace.
Amen. Keep on going.
Lord, we pray for John. Whatever John is going through right now, Lord, I pray that you just bring healing and health to his body, that you just restore him and just walk by his side each and every day.
Lord, we pray for Ken's sister Amy. Lord, I don't know what exactly is going on, but God, I ask that you bring her peace and healing and just bring her closer to you, God. Be in her life, in your name. Amen.
Lord, I pray for Sierra right now. Lord, I just pray whatever's going on in her life, that you would just give her a glimpse of hope, that you would just be with her, provide for her financially, provide for her.
Yes, Lord.
Be the miracle working God that you are in her life right now. Show her who you are. Show her how much she is loved, and just give her a glimpse of hope this week, Father.
I just want to piggyback on that prayer for Sierra. Father, you have redeemed her, and oh Jesus, right now we just pray that she would come before your throne, that she would remember who she is in you. Oh God, let surround her by your angels and by protection and rivers of living fire through the Holy Spirit around her. Oh Lord, keep her safe. Keep her protected. And oh Lord, put your hand upon her. Restore, redeem. Make her smart and wise. Oh God, redeem and restore. We just ask this for Sierra.
Lord Jesus, I pray for Matthew. Lord, Matthew is a great kid. And Lord, I ask that you would lift him up. You would give him a good... Lord, I pray for Matthew that you would give him a good experience in this troubling time, that he wouldn't be cooped up. And Lord, I pray that you would be with him in all things.
Lord, I pray for Pat. I don't know what's going on in Pat's life, but I just pray that you would just make it known that they are loved by you, that they know who you are, and that they will just continue to get their life on the right track, Father, and just give them a glimpse of hope.
Father, we lift up to you, Bill. Again, we weren't given the details, but God, we just ask that you move in Bill's life in a mighty way. God, we just ask that you bring him close to you, that physically he becomes whole and healed, and mentally and spiritually just draws close to you, God. We pray blessings upon Bill, and we just ask that he has a holy life that brings you glory. In your name, we pray.
Lord, we lift up to you, Quinn. He is an amazing son of God, and I just pray right now a blessing upon his life, that you just fill his life with hope and peace and joy, and just bring him comfort at this moment.
Yes, sir. I also pray for Amy. I pray for Amy that you would bless her and enlighten her and help her and just wrap her up in your love, oh God.
Lord, we ask your blessings on Heather's husband, Frank, that whatever he's dealing with, you give him the strength to get through it and carry on and bless him more. Bless him with success as time goes forward.
Okay, a couple more and then we're going to move on.
I pray for Gail's son, Daniel. As it said earlier in the comments that he lost his dad. Lord, just show him how much you are his Heavenly Father, that you are his Father right now as he grieves the loss of his father. Lord, I just pray that he would be watching this to know that you love him and that you care about him and you are wrapping him in his arms right now to know that his Heavenly Father is with him through this time.
Lord Jesus, I pray for Jerry. Lord, I ask that you would put your hand on Jerry and you would bless him and you would speak to him this week and that you would be with him in all the things that he's going through. Lord, just bless Jerry. In your holy name.
Father, just put your hand upon them, heal, redeem, save, encourage, bless them. Lord, we declare your love for them. Amen.
Amen.
Hey, thank you for praying. So we're going to continue on. Right now, we're going to just, because I always forget, if you're in Hope Chapel, you know I always forget, we're going to have Mike just say a couple things about tithes and offerings. But before he does, you know, this whole corona thing, right, we didn't practice this, just letting you know. This whole corona thing has caused a lot of churches to go down financially. And some of them have applied for government aid because, the government's responsible because they shut us down. They need to pay some bills. We haven't gotten that at all yet. But we also applied. But it's not really enough to cover everything. So I was wondering how we were going to pay Patrick. So Patrick is our staff 20-something pastor. And what we're doing for him, he has a job. But we try to give him a housing allowance, which is, light and heat and some rent. So I was down in the basement, and I found Patrick's housing allowance. I really did. I was searching out, and I was looking for some, how do we pay Patrick this week? And I thought, well, how are we going to pay his light and heat? Because we need to pay his utilities, right? Light and heat. So I found the light and heat. See, Patrick, if you light this candle, you get light, right? I don't know. Anybody got a match?
No.
Okay, well, you're on your own. You light this, and you have light, and if you're really cold, you just kind of hold your hand next to it, and you hold it like this, and, don't shake too hard. It lights your hair on fire. So this is your utility payment, all right? Okay, and I was thinking, well, how do we pay his mortgage? I found a whole roll of money. And we know exactly how valuable this is. This is incredibly valuable. I mean, it's been proven. People fight and die over this. So we've got the whole thing. Wait a minute. We gotta pay his May housing allowance. Okay. Don't spend it all in one place. Just saying. Okay, so you should be okay now, money-wise, because it's a spiritual thing. If you're spiritual, you'll make do, right?
Yes.
You got your money, you got your light meat, we're good.
Yeah.
Okay.
So just as a reminder, you are still able, and we still do depend on you, your tithes and offerings. So if you want to give, you can go online to hopechapel.us or hopechapel.us and do the donation there. Or you can send in checks or cash to be mailed to 667 Main Street, Keene, New Hampshire. And all of those will just go towards making sure Patrick doesn't have to eat his toilet paper. So.
So, I'm going to do a message this morning, and before I start the message, last week I want to recover something. I asked you all to be Bereans, and a bunch of you were, but there was one guy who caught me making one apparent mistake. He thought I made two, but I did make one, and I went back and rechecked the one. And I mentioned a company called VeriSign. And the name of the company, in fact, was VeriChip, and it's a defunct company. But as part of my sermon, I asked all of you to be Bereans and check everything that I said. Well, one guy did it. Dean Ogilvy, my hat is off to you. You received the Berean of the Year. You got it. And all the rest of you were lazy bums. But Dean was the guy that caught the name of the company. He checked on it, and he was right. So the name wasn't VeriSign. VeriSign is a great company. My lawyer said to say this, but no, VeriSign is a really good company. Actually, our churches use VeriSign. They verify web addresses and that sort of thing. They're great. The company that I mentioned that was into chipping people and the animals was VeriChip, not VeriSign. So my apologies, Dean. You're awesome. Good Mr. Marine there. So thank you very much. This morning, I want you to consider, and this is going to sound a little strange where you're at, but I want you to consider whether or not some of the practices that you do in your faith and in your church and Christian experience, I want you to honestly consider whether some of what you do is out of superstition or perhaps even a little bit cultic understanding in practice. And oh, I know it's not popular to talk like this, but a lot of us have had a lot of time to really think about a lot of things in the last several weeks. I actually thank God for some of the time I've had to sit and consider and carefully measure and weigh my life. And I certainly hope you're doing that. This is the time to carefully consider and weigh your life. I think it's real easy to look at everyone else and say, ooh, some of what they do is a little superstitious, or why does that group of people who call themselves Christians, why do they do that? That's a little weird. That's a little, you know, cultic. Or that group doesn't understand the Bible. Has anybody here at this table ever had that consideration for something? You said, man, they're just a little bit off.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. You terribly judgmental people. Unbelievable. Actually, all of us do it, right?
They were not conscious.
What's that?
I think it's kind of subconscious a little bit.
Yeah. We always compare everyone else to us, right?
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah. Bible says don't compare, but we do. We're all kind of guilty of that. Well, this morning, I want us to consider ourselves first. Instead of judging other people, we want to look in the mirror and think, okay, what can we learn in this time about our own practices? So the title of the sermon this morning is, are we missing something? Are we missing anything? Right now, we can't gather in big groups. We're kind of limited to these six people. Before I have our young lady share her testimony, I want you to put in the back of your mind, am I missing something? Am I missing something about myself, about what I do and how I do and how I live? So let's now panel over to Melody, and let's hear from her.
All right. Is it all set?
You got to talk real loud.
All right. Hello, everybody from the other side. I hope you guys are staying strong in this. Before I go into testimony, I want to say a couple of great things. First off, my sister Brandy down in Mexico just gave birth to her baby girl. She's on Facebook. So she did post pictures on her page, so if you want to like look over and see what she looks like, there you go. Other great news is that for some of you that know Will and Kate, recently they moved into their new apartment in Princeton. So for them, they finally have their own place and all of that. And then the last thing I should say is that pretty much I'm about 6-5 days away from my due date. So
wow.
So basically she's gonna pop out one point. May is kind of an interesting month because of the fact, not only because Mother's Day is like a week away, but it's actually a mental awareness month. And it's very interesting that it's mental awareness month at this time because we all can't be together. We're more than arm's length away from being able to reach out and connect. And not only do we need to care about our physical side, we also have to care about our mental side. And the whole Mental Awareness Month is a little bit home for me because pretty much for most of my life, I struggled with having depression. And basically, I'm at the point where I realized that I started having depression when I was growing up in a household where my parents weren't happily married, and they were always stressed out and very quick to blow up at things. And throughout the years, not only in good times, but also like the grief, bad times. And I know that when I was going through a lot of hurt and pain, it was very hard for me to be open about it because I had a dad that had that famous, or one of the common stereotypes about the older generation when they hear about the young is that when they hear people say, I'm depressed, they have the, oh, snap out of it, or just see it as, I'll just stop being sad. And because my dad had that attitude, I basically kept seeing myself as sort of a failure and just kind of kept quiet to myself. And I realized that over time, it was crushing me, and it was very hard to see the good side of things, even when everything was going right. So I guess what started me from being depressed to starting to see the lighter side of things was actually, it was actually a process. It wasn't like this nice magic wand and all of a sudden you're all better. It was through the love and patience of other people that basically had God walking in their lives when my parents weren't quite there. It was through people being patient with me, even in my shortcomings, where either if I like snapped or just kind of walled myself up to try to escape from the negativity. It was through the process of going through some of the hardest challenges in my life and having the right people come in. And I would say probably one of my biggest challenges was when I was finishing up my first year of college at Ignite, and I was coming home, but I was coming home to a divorce that was basically happening, and all my sisters were, you know, they're moved out and carry on their own lives, and like, and I was just under a lot of stress because I was coming back with no job, and, you know, I didn't really have a car and all of that. And my mom was under a lot of stress, and all of her stress and weight of the world fell upon me. And that was probably the one time I was really kind of considering, you know, leaving the world in a way that wouldn't be desirable. But things did change where over time, God, you know, still reminded me through people that I loved, and one of the biggest supporters was Jacob. And I honestly thought while dating Jacob that my struggles with depression would have been a major turnoff. Like the moment he found out that I had this struggle, that it would be more than enough for him to want to run away and be like, I'm not dealing with Tendo crazy here. But the beauty of it was that he actually did quite the opposite. And so I have a Bible verse that basically kind of helps me understand the importance of not just relying on my own stuff. So it's in Proverbs chapter 3, 5-6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to him, and he will make your path straight. So even if right now we're upset with the extended quarantine and having the fears and just, you know, everything's getting nice and sunny, but not everything's full of opened, we learned that this is all temporary, that this will pass, and that we're not meant to go through this alone. And it's okay if you're not fully like out of being discouraged and all that, because it does sometimes take a lifetime and it takes enough days to look at all the good stuff. After all, in a dark place we find ourselves, and a little more knowledge lights our way. Thank you.
to the message. What are we really missing right now? What are we missing? Well, we're missing right now, we're kind of missing worship, aren't we? Hey, Kathy and Kim, you guys miss worshiping, right? But we don't have to miss worship, because worship is just, you know, prayer and music at home or anywhere you are. You can worship God with a lot of things. We do miss coming together as a body of believers, with a whole bunch of us, with 150 people in a room at a time. We miss that in a couple of our services. We're missing teaching. Well, we are missing teaching in a big format. We're not getting together, and all over America, most states except Arkansas and a few others are still getting together, but we're not getting together. Let me just show you what the early church was all about. It says in the book of Acts, what shall we say then, brothers? I'm sorry, 1 Corinthians. What shall we say then, brothers and sisters? When you come together, each of you has a hymn, a word of instruction, a revelation, a tongue, or interpretation. And everything must be done so that the church may be built up. I don't know that we're really missing a whole lot of things that are important right now. Oh, we could be missing them. But can I tell you, there's more to our faith and our life in Jesus Christ than the comfortable patterns and behaviors and structure of, quote, church that we know about. Because really, what we're missing, church-wise, is simply a temporary expression that is actually very recent in human history and in the church history. What we do on Sunday mornings is actually a very recent, it's a very recent thing. It's not how all Christians used to practice their faith from Jesus on. This is a recent occurrence of how we do this. And when Paul was talking to the early church, you see, most churches that Paul started were just a handful of people. You know where Jesus said, where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am? Well, there was a whole bunch of small home churches that Paul started and were all over the world. And most churches, most gatherings of Christians were actually small in nature. As soon as they got to be a certain size, they would split off naturally because A, you couldn't fit in a particular home. B, there wasn't any giant cathedral or temple or tent that people would meet in because they couldn't meet publicly. And for many centuries, Christianity in many places, you had to be in hiding to practice. So you would never on purpose gather lots of people and do what we do today. What we do today is a very recent occurrence. When Paul said the church would come together, he said, really, you're coming together to build each other up and edify. Can we still do that today? Can we still edify and build each other up? Patrick, how do we build each other up today?
We make sure that we are in constant communication with someone. We give them words of encouragement. We text them. We call them. We video chat them. We even write them a letter or just buy something for them and give them a gift. You know, there's so many different ways that we could edify someone by just a simple act of kindness that can go a long way.
Absolutely. Nathaniel, how do we worship today? If we can't get together and have Kathy and Kim and a whole band and drummer girls playing, and if we can't do that, how do we worship?
Oh, we can be right around the living room just singing praises to God. We can be outside just going on a walk, going for a hike, riding your bike, and just thanking God and praising God when you're just enjoying the beauty of the great outdoors.
Michael, how do we do the teaching thing? If we can't have Joe or one of you teach and talk at us once a week, oh no, all of our input is over, that's it, life's over. How do we get teaching?
Well, I think we're doing that right now, but also that teaching is ultimately up to yourself, so pouring into the Word and doing devotionals, reading the Bible, and just getting with people and asking questions is how you get taught.
Awesome. Jacob, I'll get to you in a minute. So, Paul's understanding of church was that a handful of people would come together, and each one had something to contribute and do. One person would teach, one person would sing, You know, they would probably have the person that wasn't tone deaf be in charge of music, just saying. And that person was singing and bless people. They would have a revelation. It says you might have a revelation. Well, the early church, the book of Acts, believed in all the spiritual gifts, including prophecy and not necessarily everyone always predicting the future, but prophecy as in, I believe God is telling me or showing me that you have this issue. Jesus is here for you. So everybody had something to give. Now, the way we do church is a handful of professionals do it, or a handful of volunteers do all the ministry, and a whole other bunch of people herd in, kind of like sardines, and they sit down, and they listen to a message, they sing and clap and pray, they feel good, they put money in the plate, they shake the hand, they eat the food, and they go home. Do you hear what I'm saying? Can I tell you, that very structure is not bad. I enjoy it. We're going to get back to it. But if that's all we have, we are to be most pitied among all men. Because that is not the whole picture. It's a very small part of the picture. It can be important. We're planning on doing it. But in this verse, we see that everybody is supposed to contribute and give. Not just money and not just with their presence and their warm body. Western Christianity, for whatever reason, has evolved into the bigger, the better. Everybody have one pastor, everyone looks to one leader, and everyone come together. If we can do Colosseum worship, that's really the church. That's just cultic belief. Bigger is not better. Deeper is better. Deeper is better. Now, what does it mean? Bigger is not better, but deeper is better. Anybody, Jacob, you start.
Well, bigger, there's a lot of things that we look at that we consider bigger is bad, like ego, pride, but when you look at deep, it's like there's a lot of sayings out there that are deep, and the more you dive in, so go deep. Deeper is better. Bigger, not necessarily.
Okay, Tim.
It's the same difference as having a girlfriend who you only show up at public events for versus having a wife who you're intimate with in private. So your wife is clearly, if you're married to a person and you're having that intimate conversation and stuff, right? You're in a much better relationship than that girl that you just bring around for, like, the public. Which of these things is better? Obviously, a deep relationship with someone you love and care about, and not someone who's just there to show off, be no paper. Okay.
Good. Patrick.
Bigger, for me, is kind of surface level. It's get in, you get out. Deeper is the investment. Deeper is taking the time to get to know someone for who they are as a person, getting to spend time with them, taking the time out of your day to check in on them. It's making sure that you take the time, and when you go bigger, people can fall through the cracks, they can get unknown, they can get overlooked, but if you truly go deeper, you get to see them for who they truly are.
Jesus would minister to crowds of thousands and thousands of people, but he would spend all of his quality time with a handful. And a mentor of mine, Ralph Moore, who started all the Hope Chapel movement, he would say, do you want to be a mile wide and an inch deep, or an inch wide and a mile deep? He said, give me the mile deep and an inch wide all the time. Because that person who is rooted and grounded and centered is not going anywhere. The crowds come and go. And if you notice, Jesus, though he ministered to virtually, after 3 years, his entire nation, at the end of all that time, he really only had 150 serious believers in the upper room. 120. What was the number? Sorry, I should have looked that up. The early church was small gatherings of people, and everybody had a part, and everybody was important. It is such a good reminder. reminder for me to get back to that, because it's very easy to try, as we're growing larger, because we are as a church, as we're growing larger and people are coming, it's all exciting, and we put a lot of effort into Sundays, but can I tell you, more effort should be put into the people closest to us, and we should go deep with them. When everybody has a part to play, and they have a part to share and talk about, they become more important, and everything works the way it's supposed to. They're in the flow. They listen to the Lord. They prepare. They pray. They're focused. Right now, the way most churches run is only a handful of people actually take 10, 20, 30 minutes before the gathering to pray and really ask God and seek Him for His direction. And only a very small handful of people actually, you know, amp up and ramp up and get ready for that time. And it's so precious to them. We call them leaders. We call them staff. We call them our pastors and our deacons and elders. But can I tell you that that's what we all should be doing, because everybody should aspire to have an important place within the local body, because everybody is important. And can I tell you, large gatherings are not wrong. They can be very helpful. They are good for our city and our communities we live in. There's nothing wrong with large gatherings. And we're going to do them. We're going to do them well. Large gatherings of more than a dozen people up till this time were always the extra. It was the icing on the cake. What was important was what happened with a handful of your friends in private. So this is a good reminder. Because people who are gathering together, when three or four or five people gather together, or even 10 or 12 gather together, and everybody's contributing something, they become very effective people. And effective people are more aware, they're more disciplined, so we get the word disciple from, and they are able to share the gospel and they bear more fruit. I'm going to say it to you directly. People who are actively involved when the body of Christ comes together, who are actively involved, those are typically the people that automatically, out of the overflow of the Holy Spirit in their life, they're the ones who automatically bring their neighbor to Christ, share it with their cousin, bring their Uncle Fred, they're the ones who end up praying for the single mom at the grocery store in line in front of them. Those are the people, because they are active and they are intentional, they're the ones who have Jesus awareness. They have Holy Spirit awareness. They are gospelly, that's a good one, Joeism, gospelly aware. They are aware of the people around them. And so we want you to be disciples and be more effective. Sometimes, in larger gatherings, it's easier to hide. I've talked to friends of mine who went through a difficult time at a small church, and they left that small church and they went to a big one so they could just sit and hide. Some went to sit and heal, totally fine. Some went to sit and hide. They went to a church. They actually told me this. They went there because nobody would know their stuff. So really what they did was they exchanged a form of godliness and they denied its power of change. You see, the body of Christ, we need to be transparent and open. There should be no secrets. Oh, you don't have to tell everybody all your stuff. But there needs to always be a handful of people who love you, who you feel loved by, and you love them, and you openly and transparently share at the depth of your soul what you're thinking and going through. Because when you have that, you go deep and you're safe and you work with each other. Sometimes larger gatherings of churches, Coliseum, I call them rock star churches. Ooh, who's your pastor? Sometimes what ends up happening is that you create a structure whereby most people don't participate. And you think, well, they participate. If I'm a leader and I'm doing that, if I'm a pastor and I get this giant Coliseum church, and maybe we have a church that's that big. I just don't want them all focused on me or on our church, because then we become cultic, right? But maybe grow big. But a lot of times when that happens, you create an environment where people don't really participate. And people like me in charge will say, well, you know, we try to justify. We go, well, they're participating by coming. They're coming, and they're going to influence people outside, and they're going to do all the things. Yeah, most of that is not true. Most of that is not true. Most Christians in America and in the Western world, what they have is Sunday morning. That's about what they have, and that's really sad. In our country, if you start talking to another person that you find out is a Christian, what's the first thing that comes up in conversation? Hey, what church do you go to? Hey, what church do you go to? Well, you know, even that question, can I tell you? It's natural, it's not wrong, but it is a little bit cultic. Do you know why? Why is that question cultic, gentlemen? Put your thinking caps on. What church do you go to?
I go to the Church of Jesus Christ. Because we're all one body. It doesn't matter if you're Catholic, it doesn't matter if you're Baptist or Orthodox, it doesn't matter if you're Lutheran, Methodist, we're all the same because we all believe in Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. And we need to stop going after one another. We should be going after the world who's unsaved.
Right. What's a better question? When you meet a Christian, what's a better question?
Where do you meet?
Yeah, what local gathering do you attend? Because we're local gatherings. There's only one church. We say that, but then in our words, we act all separatist. We do. But there is only one church. And in that church are Baptists and Catholics and Lutherans and Pentecostals and heaven to Betsy. There's Seventh-day Adventists. And there's people who don't belong to any one of those historically and cultural groups, historical and cultural groups, or tribes or divisions. There are people who just know and walk with Jesus, and they meet with a handful of people in somebody's living room. And they are, but they're not really the church, are they?
Yes, they are.
They are. But they don't come. Well, they don't come to Hope Chapel.
They follow Jesus.
Can you follow Jesus and not go to Hope Chapel?
Yes.
You have to.
Yes.
Oh, religion is falling off me.
It helps.
Oh, man, it helps. but what if? So they can just love Jesus and they're okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Generally, that's how it works.
What if they're only fellowshipping with two people?
That's the church.
Yeah. It is written, wherever two or more are gathered in my name, I will be there.
But that means I might not get my Colosseum church.
Yep. So what?
Yep.
Two or more? Who said that? Who messed up my plans?
Jesus.
Oh. Oh, well. Do we see how sometimes our thinking is a little bit religious and cultic? It's really sad, but this is a good time to evaluate. In America and in the Western culture, there's a whole lot of emphasis, and also in Orthodox and in Catholic, everywhere in the world, we do something that we do, but it doesn't make it right that we do it. We put a leader on a pedestal. You can talk about it.
The phone's gonna die soon.
Okay. We put people on a pedestal and we say, Pastor, teach us, feed us, pray for us, give my family security, Pastor, take care of us. And there are people who go to churches and they set up churches in structure so that people can come and be taken care of. And can I tell you that that is so wrong. Now, being taken care of and loved and helped, that's all part of it, but that is not the purpose. When people come to me and they say, Pastor Joe, take care of me, help me. You know what I say? I say, help yourself. Pick yourself up by the bootstraps. I'm going to pray for you. God's going to touch you. And you're going to stand on your feet like a man. You're going to become a powerful woman. You are going to rock and shock the world. You are going to be the salt and light. So when you come to me, I'm not going to pick you up and cuddle you and hold you like a baby and say, there, there, it's going to be okay. I'm not really good at that. There are people who are good at that. It is not me. I believe that you are responsible for yourself, and we are all called to adulthood. I believe that you take care of your family, and then you take care of a friend or two. Whose responsibility is it to take care of you? It's yours. And if you got some good friends who love you and appreciate you, and will kick you in the fanny to get you going, and will feed you when you're hungry, and you can partner with, well, you are came to me and they said, Pastor Joe, we want you to talk to our teenagers about abstinence and sexuality. And inside, I immediately went, okay, good, I can do that. I know all about that. I have all the college and training and Bible courses, and I had problems in my life. That was never one of them. I did it right. I did all those things right. And I went to say, okay, I'm going to, and I got this little check. And I talked to the mom and dad, and I said, okay, you know, I don't mind helping you with this scenario, but have you had that talk with your own kids? And this is what they told me. Oh, no, we can't. I said, what do you mean you can't? They said, oh, no, you see, when we were their age, we were doing all kinds of crazy stuff sexually with all kinds of people. We got saved later. We came to Christ later. We were in a church when we were bad, and we were hypocritical. We were just doing all kinds of crazy stuff, and so we don't want our kids to know about that. We want you to tell them that they can't have sex before marriage. And I thought to myself, wow, this is really, really dysfunctional. And I have a choice to make. Do I take the place of parents as a paid professional, and do I do something for someone that they should be doing themselves, or do I help the parents mature and grow to the point where they can be honest with their own children and have adult conversations? So I took door number two, and that couple promptly said, hey, we pay you to have these conversations. This is what we pay you for. And I said, you do not pay me for that. And that couple went and found another church to be in right away. And it was sad. But I realized that part of that, we have fostered, when we foster an expert and when we foster professional clergy who are paid to do the job that we don't always want to do. Is some of our practice in the American church, is it a little bit religious and is it a little bit cultic? My answer is absolutely yes. And when we're evaluating, do we evaluate everyone else? No, we have to evaluate ourselves. We start right here. That was just one example. But you know, when we got the Old Testament, we had Moses. And Moses came out of Egypt, right? He grew up in Pharaoh's household. And if you want to look at how authority and how structure worked, that Moses was very familiar with, he came out of the pyramid structure. Pharaoh on top, a high priest who was the spiritual leader. Pharaoh was the natural leader. The high priest of whatever cult that Egypt was part of at the time was a spiritual leader. When he left, he was the natural leader and spiritual, but Moses Aaron was his mouthpiece. And what you have is Moses, by nature of where he came from, viewed authority in the up and down pyramid fashion. God uses people where they at, and he speaks to them as they come out of where they're at. And people are in process. So the authority we have in the Old Testament is top to bottom, a great big pyramid structure, leader on top, everyone else on the bottom. The leader makes a declaration, everybody else follows. Did you know that that doesn't work? Have we come to a place in our development as humans and as Christians, just with the words of Jesus, that we know that that doesn't work? If that worked, if the Moses style of running organizations and people and operating as leadership under that style, did you know that if that actually worked, we would not be sitting here right now? Jesus said, rulers of the Gentiles, rulers of pagans, lord it over the people they're in charge of. But not so with you. There is a top-down approach that the whole world is structured in. And Jesus said, that is not your structure. You are not in the pyramid. You are not climbing any ladder. You are not the top of the food chain. And that's where everything kind of goes wrong. Because we had Moses who went to God about the Ten Commandments. Ten Commandments were awesome. We still operate by the principles in them. Nothing wrong with that. It's all part of our heritage. I love the Ten Commandments. People were ruled, and the people listened to the guy at the top. Well, when that went away, we started other things. We have most churches actually follow that structure. And it's the wrong structure. I'm just telling you, it's the wrong structure. The Catholic Church, they've got, instead of Moses, they've got the Pope. And they got the Pope's disciples called the Cardinals. And they have, the Cardinals have, you know, you just keep on going down the food chain until you've got the masses. And it is 100%, it is a pyramid structure. The Baptists say, oh, look at the Catholics, look how they do that wrong. Yet they put their pastor on top, and they have their deacons and elders, and then they have the food chain. It's the pyramid scheme. It's really what it is. Leadership is not bad. There's nothing wrong with having a leader. There is positional leadership, but it's not the pyramid scheme. We all fall short. There's a promise in Scripture in the Old Testament that I love, and it says that the government, referring to Jesus, will be on his shoulders, the structure, the governing, how things work. At some point in our future, will be on the shoulders of Jesus himself, and I cannot wait for that time. This is why there isn't revival, I think. I don't think revival isn't here because people sin. You know, everybody sins. You and I, we all sin. I think if we were honest, I read some George Barna studies who asked very detailed questions to Christians, and the truth of the matter is a very large percentage of Christians do not live any different than people who call themselves non-Christians. I think that there's not revival, not because of sin, but I think that sometimes we're doing things a little off from what Jesus wanted. And if we do it the way Jesus wanted, I think we're going to have a whole lot more influence and a whole lot more people coming to Christ in revival. The way America does church that we just got interrupted, some of it works really, really well, and we want to do that. But some of it doesn't work so well, and that part needs to go away. Now, you might say to me, Joe, what do you mean some of what we do doesn't work well? All right, so I read a study last night from George Barna and Crossways and a couple other ones. They asked the same question, and they all came up with the same percentages, which was really scary. They said that the majority of Christians out there, anywhere from 66 to 80% of Christians, believe a pastor has to live at a higher moral standard than they personally do. I'm going to say that again. The majority of Christians in our country absolutely believe, probably two-thirds, not just of those other local churches, but our church, probably two-thirds of you watching believe that a pastor needs to live at a higher moral standard than you yourself would live at. And what happens is, in our country, is we tend to judge the people at the top of the pyramid, at the top of the ladder, more than we judge ourselves. Is that true or not? It is very true. Can I tell you that that is a cultic belief that limits revival? And it doesn't limit it in the pastor, it limits it in the people who believe that. Because by intent, if they say, well, I'm not up there, I don't have that responsibility, I can kind of live down here and I'm okay, as long as I come to the church, put my money on the plate, shake hands, smile real big, pretend that everything's good when it's really not, I'm good because I'm a Christian. Well, if that's the definition of a Christian, count me out. Really think about that. The reason we do that, and believe me, I thought about it. Have I ever felt that way? Absolutely, I felt that way. Why do I feel that way? Because it's how I was conditioned early on. There's the pastor, there's the Pope, there's the leader. Oh, the President of America, President Donald Trump. Oh, we're going to hold him to a higher standard than we hold ourselves to. Is that what's happening all over our country? Absolutely. Well, that is a very, very hypocritical thing. Here's why we think that's okay spiritually. Bad teaching. It says in the Bible, it says, my brothers, do not many of you seek to become teachers, because we know that teachers are held to greater accountability. Is that what the Bible says? Okay. But what's that talking about? Is that higher accountability on a human level or on a God level? It's says they will be judged with a higher level of accountability. Who's the judge? Who's the judge? Jesus Christ. So we teach, we answer to God at a higher level. That is absolutely true. And why is it a higher level? Because a teacher or a pastor or someone who is perceived to be at the top, or who are really at the bottom carrying the weight of people, but they're perceived to be at the top, they influence a whole lot of people. You see, we can judge according to people we influence. That's the higher judgment. If you affect one person negatively, or you affect 1,000 people negatively that Jesus wants, that Jesus loves, there is a different form of judgment. There's a higher level of accountability. That's why when we lay hands on leaders and we put people in charge of our children, we are very careful with those people, right? Because they affect and influence lots of people we love and care about. So that's what it's talking about. It's not talking about it's okay to judge somebody else by a different standard than you judge yourself, right? We're supposed to treat others the way we want to be treated. We're supposed to judge not, lest we be judged. And by the same measure we measure for other people is the same measure that will be measured back. Whether people appreciate or like our president or not, we have 50% or 40% or 30% of our United States keeping judgment on themselves for holding our president to a different moral standard than they themselves currently live at. That's a very dangerous place to be. Not just this current president, but any president, any human being. We have to give them the same grace and space, whether they're Christian or non-Christian, whether they're saved or unsaved, whether they're in our church or not. We give them the same grace and space that we want them to give us. Someone say amen to that.
Amen.
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 Okay, 10%. Okay. We're getting close to the end here. Think about it. In our nation, the majority of Christians believe, and because they believe it, they somehow carry out actions by this, that it's okay to hold the people at the top, the pastors, at a higher level of responsibility than they themselves. And that right there kills Jesus' intent for humanity. It kills it. Because all we like sheep have gone astray. There aren't any special people at the top. We're all the same. We have different responsibilities, different gifts, and we all work. We all contribute. Here's another reason why I know it's true, that we are just a little bit off in our perceptions here. Because 80% of all pastors ever surveyed, 80%, state that ministry in the body of Christ has greatly negatively impacted their family. That being a pastor or leader of a big organization has cost them their family. It has harmed their wife, their children, their finances, their emotions, their life. It has shortened their life. Do you know which industry is the most unhealthy? Pastors. Do you know who lives shorter lives than anybody else? Pastors. Now you're thinking, Joe, you're preaching out of your own back pocket. Well, it's true, but I'm not one of those people because I've decided to make some huge, big changes. No big announcements today, I promise. But we're not doing that stuff at our church. I'm not saying it hasn't happened. I'm just saying we're just going to use this time to reevaluate everything we do in all regards. I made a decision. My wife and I were talking. I made a decision when we first started our church, and I said this, and I've said it from day one for the last 20 plus years. I will always choose my family before a local church. I will always choose my wife over helping somebody else. I will always choose my son or my daughter's problems and time I have to spend with them before I spend any with you. And I hope that you understand that that's a good thing, not a bad thing. That I'm not on anybody's beck and call, that we are all here to help each other. And that our first area of responsibility a man has or a woman has is their own family. Someone say amen to that.
Amen.
Right. So my family's responsibility isn't four squares, and it's not any, it's mine. It's my family. It's my responsibility. They come first. I hope your family comes first. It's not spiritual to sacrifice your family and kids for the gospel. It's why when we were going to college, my wife and I, all of our friends that were pastors' kids, most of them were terrible. The pastors' kids were the worst ones because they knew that they came second to the ministry. So we just don't, in the main household, at Hope Chapel, hopefully at all the Hope Chapels, we just don't do that. Here's another thing where I know that we got to change. All of us. Everywhere in the world. Well, that's a big brush, huh? That's a broad brush. The condition of a local church is not more important than the condition of the neighborhood. Think about that. But that's not how we live. That is not how we live. The condition of a local church is not more important than the condition of the neighborhood. And the condition of your local church is not more important than the condition of your neighborhood. Jesus said, love your neighbors. He didn't say build a church building. He didn't say build a religion. He said, love your neighbors. So I'm going to tell you straight up and quote me, the condition of your neighborhood is not less important. I'm sorry. The condition of your local church is not more important than the condition of your neighbors. In fact, I'm going to tell you, your neighbors come first. If your neighbors comes first, you'll be surprised how fast the local church grows. Is it supposed to be that? What comes first, the neighbors or the church building? The neighbors. Oh, I know, Hope Chapel, we've had some problems with our neighbors. We are working on that. But it wasn't all our fault. We were doing our best. I want you to think about that. And the condition of the local church is not more important than the condition of your family. The condition of a local church is not more important than the condition of your marriage. You know, there are Christian leaders who go to a church and they divorce within that church. And it's okay because they still have a job and they're helping the church. No, no, no. Stop everything. Fix your family and then step back and be into leadership. The condition of a local church is not more important than the condition of the people coming and their families. That's why it gets a little cultic sometimes. That's why I hate religion. Because religion places other things in front of people that Jesus loves. We've got to stop doing that. The finances of a corporate church are not more important than the finances of the families that come to that church. It is more important to me whether, and I'm into finishing our building project and putting on, you know, the building, and we are still doing our very best to move forward. It might take some time. But can I tell you, of far more importance to me is are our families eating and paying their bills, and do they not have financial stress? It is more important to me that our families prosper than our local church prospers financially. Because if our families prosper, the local church will prosper. See, God has an order. So if you're doing well, here's my friends, my five amigos. You know what we sit around and talk about? How to get out of debt, how to have a better paying job. Why everyone can earn at least $25 an hour. I mean, we cover that kind of stuff because that's what's important to me. Because if they prosper and everything works well, the whole church prospers. Do you see how that works? What's my percentage on battery? I got 5%. Okay, I got 5 more minutes. Not even. All right. The time you spend, here's another religious slash cultic thing. There are families all over America where the parents force their kids to go to a church on a Sunday morning for 2 hours. But that family doesn't spend 2 hours together during the week hiking a mountain or going to a movie or holding hands or playing in the park, throwing frisbees. Think about that. And that, I don't think that's ever been publicly corrected anywhere. I want you to think about that. Because that's a religious, cultic behavior. There are families, I'll say it again, who make sure their kids go to church, right? For 2 hours, but they can't spend 2 hours with their children in a park throwing a frisbee. Hey, I've been guilty. And it wasn't that I tried to do that, it's just that you get so busy, right? We just get so busy. We get on the hamster wheel. We get busy. Well, can I tell you, let's reevaluate what we do. And this week, I'm going to see a whole bunch of you in the park. Yes, I said that. Throwing frisbees, or watching your grandkids throw frisbee, or doing something fun. Because I think it's okay to enjoy life with who God put around us. So what are we missing? What are we really missing? I don't know that we're missing much. I mean, I'm looking forward to getting together with you, hugging and slobbering on each other. I'm going to do that again. But we're not yet missing anything we can't regain very, very fast. But I don't want you to miss out on life or what God intends. Don't miss out on life or what God intends. The early church was two or three gathered in one place. Right now, can I tell you, you can still do that. Right now, we can gather six here. It's okay. It's all right. We're not going to get the COVID-19. I got tested twice. I'm clear twice. All right? We're not going to get it. If we do, it's a virus. But you can gather with two or three non-at-risk people, and you can talk, encourage, pray. You can be the body of Christ right where you're at, because you are the body of Christ. You can open up your house or your apartment. You can bring two or three or four people in. You can do that. It's not even against the law yet. That'll be another conversation at some other point. Is your house or your apartment open to people? Because, boy, it's time for you to let the church in, for you to be the church, because there's only one. Is the condition of your neighborhood more important than the condition of your church? Is the condition of your neighbor more important than the condition of your offering? Do you love your religion more than your neighbor? I guess I'm going to stop with that, because I really want you to really think some of this out. And Tim is going to close us in prayer. Lord Jesus, holy is your mighty name. Lord, teach us how to be the church in our neighborhoods. Lord, show us how to live out your words in our lives around other people and in our private lives with our families. And Lord, show up and meet with us weekly. What seems we can't gather, Lord, instead, show us how intimate we can be with you in our private lives, since we can't meet you publicly in the corporate church. So, Lord, lead us and guide us into all things, and show us who we should speak to as we meet them this week. And show us and teach us how to love people the way you love them. In your holy name, amen.
Amen.
Let your light shine.